Where did this start for you? Was this like an idea that came out of the ether? Were you listening to a Beatles album and
No, it came from the real life. You know, I was having holidays on Almeria, which is a beautiful part of the south of Spain, Andalusia, and close to the beach. And I took my kids there. And one day in 2006, I was reading some local newspaper, and they were putting a monument on John Lennon in one square in Almeria City, because they were remembering that 40 years before, in 66, Lennon was in the town, and they feel very proud of that, and so they were putting it. And I was like, oh, look at this, you know, again, another John Lennon square, because there's one in every city in the world. And I told my kids, you know, he came here in 66 to do a film, the How I Won the War, the Richard Lester movie. And because in Almeria they were shooting a lot of spaghetti western, a lot of Second World War movies and all that, and so it was all the time these American actors coming and staying in there 1 month, and everybody was telling anecdotes of Almeria and these guys. But at the end of the article, it was a story, and it said, like, it was around this old teacher telling the story when he was teaching with the Beatles songs for his students to learn English, and he knew that Lennon was in Almeria, so he went to see him and asked him to correct the notebooks and to complete the lyrics of Revolver, because he was listening to Radio Luxembourg. At the time was the free radio that everyone was listening for this kind of music, because it was not in the public, in the Spanish radio. So he was taking notes from the radio every time they, because he wanted the kids to know the lyrics and to translate the lyrics before the record came out in Spain. So that was a way to put him, put them in the English, and to. So I read that and I said, here's a great character for a movie, you know, this teacher. You know, I love that kind of people, you know, it has that determination and that purity and that thing. But I didn't have a movie in my mind, so I have only the character, like saying, it's an interesting guy. So some months later, there was a connection in my mind between that and a family story about I come from a big family, you know, I'm the eighth of eight.
Wow.
And you know, my mother always told me the story that my second brother ran out of home because he wanted to have long hair. He was a very admirer of the Lennons and Beatles and Rollins and the Kings. And so my father was a very authoritarian father, and he said, no, you have to cut your hair. I was born in 69, so it was around 69. So my mother told me that she was breastfeeding me because my brother ran out of home for 3 or 4 days, and she was crying, like thinking, where is my boy, you know, he left home and for this stupid discussion with my father, and he has to change my clothes every time. So
because you were wet?
Because I was wet with the tears. And that was for me great, and I always said that it was my baptism, my real baptism was that. And so those two ideas, because my brother went to another side of Spain, to a beach, to work in a bar, and he spent 3 days there until the moment the owner of the bar called my father and said, well, I have this kid here, he's a very nice guy, and he says there is no problem, that his parents knows about it, but I'm curious about it because he's a very well-educated guy. He's nice, and I think he can do better in a school than here working in a bar, you know, in this forgotten place. So my father said, no, please take him there because I'm going to get him because we have this argument at home, and you know, it's stupid. He ran away, and so he went to look for him. So that a story that made together in both stories. And I decided that it was a good start to try to talk about that time in Spain and in the world, in the whole world, that I think mentality of the people started to change a lot. And I put another real anecdote about a girl I knew that was pregnant at the time, and they were like hiding her for the neighborhood and all the family relatives, and because they didn't know that she was single and she was pregnant, and you know, they wanted to throw away the key to adopt or whatever. So, mm-hmm. so she was having that problem, and I put all the three together, and I said, let's talk about that. And
so was your, I mean, it's, was your authoritative, is that the right word I'm looking
yeah.
for? Authority heavy father. I mean, is that part of the reason why your family has blossomed artists?
Well, I hope not. He was a very authoritative person, but at the same time, he was very creative, and he was very eccentric, which is always a good thing to have an artist in the family. Mm-hmm. They were, my parents, they didn't have the luck to get to school, so they were not, they came from, after the war, there was a big immigration to the big cities in Spain, so mm-hmm. everybody was leaving their villages and started a new life in the town, trying to get some money. So they met my father and my, so they were very poor in Madrid at that mm-hmm. time. So art was not something that they were worried about, and culture or films. My father never went to see a movie, you know, mm-hmm. in a theater. Until, you know, when they were old, or they were taking us one day to see Ben-Hur or something like that, very important. Mm-hmm. But at the same time, they were very, they knew that a good education is going to be the only way to bring the kids out of our status, to raise a little bit. So they were a little bit destroyed when my friend, my brother Fernando decided to become a director and try to direct movies, because they were like, that's not a job. At that time, you know, now it's a trendy thing for a kid to say to their parents, but, you know, when my brother said to that, it was, you know, like, oh my God, this is terrible, you know.
He's and really how much older than you is he?
He's 15 years older
15 years
than
older.
Me. And he's my third, he's the third one. And so they were a little bit destroyed. So they were not pro artist, so mm-hmm. but you know, they have a you know, they have to agree with Fernando that it was a good move for him, you know, he yeah. raised his life was good, and so they were happy with him. And so for me it was much easier, because I was a writer since I was 7, you know, I was writing all the time, and so my parents, they already knew that I was going to be something like that, you know. Mm-hmm. It will be a surprise if I finish saying I'm going to be a doctor, you know. They will be like, what?
So were you, I mean, is having a brother who is becoming famous and all of that, does that make you want to be like him, or does it make you want to kind of push away and find your own space that's different?
Well, I never had the ambition to be famous. I was, Fernando, he is a very known director, and when I was 11 years old, he did, or 10 years old, he did Opera Prima, who was a big, big success in Spain, and mm-hmm. so he became very known and very respected. But, you know, fame for me was not a, it was not an ambition, you know, it was something that goes with your work. So I wanted to write, I wanted to tell stories, I wanted to be a writer, writing was my, so when I was 15, 14, some of my friends wanted to make short films, and they didn't know how to write. They knew they wanted mm-hmm. to be directors, but they didn't know how to write something.
So everybody wants to be the director.
They asked me, why don't you write for us one of your stories? And I said, oh, yeah, perfect. So I started to write, and I started to feel that I knew more about films than them, because also I was going to the cinema all the time, and I was, you know, very into things. So one day I started to shoot my own things, and then I started to write as a screenwriter for others, and mm-hmm. so it was like a natural movement for me. So I never have the feeling like I want to be like Fernando, or I want to be, no.
You're just doing your own thing.
Yeah, you're doing your own thing, and Fernando is, he's a so generous guy and so funny and good person that he made my life very easy, trying to be a filmmaker too and a writer. So he was like helping and saying, okay, what do you want to do? And, oh, it's great, that idea, you should do it, yeah.
So when you started making films when you were that age, when you were young, were you doing it on videotape, or were you still on Super 8? Or?
I started in Super 8, and then we started to use the first camera, video camera I saw in my life. It was a video camera with with a bag. You have to put a bag here, very heavy, and then the camera with a cable. And it was very funny, but for us at that time it was like, because cinema, to do 35 millimeters, even 16 was like for rich people, you know, we cannot do it. So these cameras started the what is happening now, even the democratization of the film directors, you know. You don't have to be like a Formula One driver, you know, that it's impossible if you don't have, you know, some people put in the money because, you know, it's a too expensive to be something that you can do. And cinema was like that. To make a, you know, a 35 camera, it was like a Formula One, you know. Right.
Were there schools? Was there schools with 16?
No, at the time,
like
in Spain, no. No, no, I even came to a school here. I studied at AFI, but I was already a screenwriter in Spain when I came to perfectionate my knowledge here in Los Angeles. And
so what was that like?
That was fun, because I came from a country and from a, you know, Europe. The author kind of cinema is the most, it was at that time the most prominent, you know, and the most important. A young guy who wanted to be a director in Madrid or in Barcelona, he wanted to be Antonioni, Truffaut, Romer, Fellini. He wanted to be an author. He didn't want to be. He didn't want to do E.T. at the time. You know, we were looking at E.T. and it was great, but we were looking about some other things. So I came here, and I discovered the completely opposite approach to cinema, which was more Hollywood oriented, like audience and entertainment and money and production and things. And it was very good to contrast these two schools, and I always say that I'm a, you know, probably a product of this friction in between these two schools, because I'm an author. I write my own scripts. I do my own films, and I'm detect very much when an author is interesting, and you know, I kind of like a director like Alexander Payne much better than some technical great director. You know, I kind of like the way he writes and he does movies, but at the same time, you know, I'm always in my mind what I learned here, you know, that you have to respect the audience, you have to respect the people who put the money, you have to, you work in an industry, at the same time it's your art and expression, so you have to put all those things together in order to be as a satisfying movie director. So. So for me, that's the perfect idea of a director, is someone that is responsible of the industrial side of his work and the experience of the audience in a cinema, in a theater, but at the same time, he doesn't renounce to tell his own stories, the things he has in his head.
Mm-hmm. So is that part of how you do your movie? Is the movie like this? I mean, it's a kind of a beautiful road trip.
Yeah,
but it doesn't seem like an overly expensive movie. It seems like you kind of kept it close to the vest. Is that all by design?
So because in Spain it was not considered a commercial movie when I started to do it. So we didn't bring a lot of money to make the movie. It was very difficult to get finance of the movie. And it's not a problem for me. You know, I'm used to tight financial, you know, amounts of money to my films and to do it in a few days and working very fast, but at the same time that's freedom, that gives you freedom, because sometimes they put the money but they start to tell you the film they want you to make, and I'm not that kind of director, you know. I have an idea and I always say to them, trust my idea, you know, it's gonna be better. If not, we're gonna do, you know, like a stupid movie with three heads. And you know, the movies had to have a vision on them and a personality. But it is not all of this is not a theory that I'm making in every film. It is something that is inside you. It's your way. It's like when you walk your way. You don't ask your legs, okay, the light, left, right, left. No, it's something natural. For me, it's natural. The way I write, the stories that attract me, the way I put together a movie and I do the movie with this type of actors and this type of production, and the way I write my novels, it is something that I don't design. It is in myself, you know.
So does it, I mean, how far, in terms of the process, in terms of a script like this coming to its fruition, are you pretty much doing a draft and then tinkering? Or are you just doing it over and over and over again until, you know, the shooting time? Are you, how locked in are you on the material when you start?
Oh, I'm very, very locked to the material, but I'm, as a good director, screenwriter, I have the chance to change things very easily because you know the material, so you detect what is wrong and what is going to be better if you find mm-hmm. something very easily. Sometimes other directors can, you know, even think, oh, I'm not going to change that because the writer is going to think I'm ruining the whole thing, and mm-hmm. maybe I'm ruining the whole thing because you're not the writer. But in my case, I know what I'm doing, and so if a better idea approaches, it's like, oh my God, take it. You know, that's for me, of a good spot to shot. You know, I have a small team, and I used to say to them, you know, let's gonna use it as an advantage. Mm-hmm. Let's not like have the same way of working as if we are working in a 45 million euro picture. So mm-hmm. let's work and let's take profit that we have a small team and we can change the day, and we can change the location, and we can change everything because we are free to do it. Because we can do it. We are flexible. They cannot do it. You know, they feel very miserable doing these big productions. I feel very, as a director, I feel very confident with that.
So do you find it? Do you do a lot of rehearsal, or do you have them read through everything a lot, or?
For me, the writing is the rehearsal of a movie. You know, you're uh-huh. writing and you're changing and you're proving and you're testing and you're chain lines and you're. So in the moment the actor centers, I'm like giving them the whole thing, like explaining to them what I want, what are the reasons that I wrote the way it is written in the script, mm-hmm. and how I want the picture to be and to look and whatever. I give them all the information that I have, but I gave them the freedom to, you know, to grow the character inside mm-hmm. and make me a proposition. And I always say to them, everything we do in this office is not going to be so important as the things we're going to do in front of the camera the day of shooting. So let's not get crazy in the rehearsals about trying to raise all the emotions and all the truth, mm-hmm. because that is something that we're going to have to do it later. Now, let's do an intellectual, a very cerebral approach to the material. It's like, do you understand everything that is here? Do you understand why you do it? Do you understand the way the character behaves and hides things and does things that way? And if it, because I always explain to them what are the relation between the things that happen in the movie and the way I wrote it and why I wrote like that. You know, it's like explaining to them, you know, that happened to one friend of mine that had that problem, and mm-hmm. he said to me one day that, and they're like, oh, that's useful material for an actor. So I work like that with them, and then they do the job, and they are, you know, I'm always happy because they get a lot of awards, my actors, and some people think that I'm a very good director of actors and actresses, and I always said to them, no, the only talent I have is that I choose them right, and I create the ambience for them to be as best as they can, mm-hmm. and usually they are very good. So to be at best, they only need, you know, the confidence of the director, mm-hmm. like, he, you know, this guy here, he's gonna permit me to get wrong, mm-hmm. and he's gonna protect me, which is what they need in order to get very creative and very free. And
well, most direct actors I talk to would say that's what does make it a good director.
Really? Oh, great.
I mean, that's the
well, because there are sometimes actors that they feel more confident if they rehearse a lot.
Right.
A lot. And for instance, Javier Cámara in Vivires Fácil told me, you know, I always rehearse a lot, every film I prepare a lot. And I said, why, are you not prepared to be an actor or why, you know? It's like, I was teasing him, like, you know, for me, the script is all the job, you know? Mm-hmm. I remember I listened to an interview with John Malkovich some time ago. He did this role, bad guy in that film called In the Line of Fire, mm-hmm. with Clint Eastwood. he was doing the guy who was trying to kill the president of the United States, so the typical bad guy. So the journalist asked him if he, in what way he prepared his character, if he went to meet with the psychotic killers or or police or cops that explained to him the way they think. And he was like very surprised, and he said, you know what? All the research for my characters, I prefer that the writer does it. and that was a good answer. Because it's true, if it's not in the script, it's not gonna be in the screen.
Well, it's fascinating how every, you know, actors each all have their own, they have their own methods, but then they also have their own preferences.
Yeah.
Along the way, we were talking to the actress from Gone Girl,
yeah,
who was very actually happy with David Fincher shooting so many takes.
Really?
And then you have actors who are like, I want to do my two takes and I'm out, you know, unless something happens with the camera. Yeah. I got it right then. It's done.
Well, I always say to the actors that they have to be very selic, kind of chameleon kind of person, you know, because if you're shooting with David Fincher and he's doing 60 takes for an actor, this is probably a loss of control totally of what they're doing. Because if you do something 60 times, you're losing your control. Maybe that's what the director wants, and you know, and so the best for an actor to do is enjoy. Enjoy that way, because if you fight against that, and if you start to say, hey man, the third was perfect, I'm not doing anymore, so you're ruining the picture, you're ruining your relationship with the director. So I always say to them, even if you think it's stupid to do 60 takes, which I think it is, let's play.
Right.
If he wants to play at that, let's play it. And maybe the 16th take is better, you know, never know.
Well, similarly, we were just talking to people from Birdman, and for that movie, it was extremely structured physically because of the camera work. You know, they were doing these long, long takes, and all the actors seemed to kind of get off on it. You know, it was like, it was a bit like doing theater, and it was, you know, like walking a tightrope, because if anybody made one little mistake, they were done for, that afternoon. And they apparently did like every section of it at least 10 times, but it was, it sounds like it was such a different experience. Definitely. That they were like pleased to have the fun of doing it, you know?
Yeah. Well, but when you films, I always say the same thing. We know a lot about the way the films are made, and we have a lot of information right now about the films, but what it counts is the results. And I don't care the way they did it if the result, I love it, you know? Mm-hmm. And when you see a film like Unforgiven, you know, the Clint Eastwood movie, and you see those great characters and those great actors doing it, like Morgan Freeman, Clint, Gene Hackman, and Richard Harris, you see how they are in that movie. Mm-hmm. And when they tell you that they did one or two takes, it's like, okay, I'm gonna do it in my next film, I'm gonna do it in one, two takes. Well, bring Gene Hackman here, you know, he's... But yeah. I will feel very ridiculous if Gene Hackman get in a movie and somebody asks him to do 60 takes.
Yeah.
So Clint Eastwood probably, he's a very intelligent guy, you know. Or Woody Allen, you know, he works like that. And they're always good actors, you know.
Yeah.
You see the actresses in Woody Allen's movies, and they never get so well in any other movie. So you know what they tell you if you ask him? I don't know what I'm doing, you know, because he's so fast and so confident, and he's so happy the way I do it, that he didn't tell us anything at all. You know, he writes the lines, which is better, perfect. And so I feel more close to that kind of directors, that they don't pretend to be the owner of the whole thing. You know, it's like, because a film it has to be your vision, but it has to be a piece where everybody's involved in a very, putting together what they have inside. So if you castrate them, if you make them feel that you are the only master of the universe, that's going to be a problem. It's better to invite them to the party.
So as you say, for some directors, that may be their trick, it may be their stroke, you know?
Yeah, yeah.
And for others, it may not. Some actor was saying over and over again, actually, but they were saying that, you know, it's nobody wants to see your work. You know, like nobody cares all the work you did as an actor before you got on the screen. They're interested in the performance, that moment, you know, they want to have the emotional experience that they're having, not wonder about how you got there or how the director got there.
All the work, you know, it's like you see a painting or an sculpture, and And you don't care about the if he made 30 paintings before to get to this one. You only care about the emotion that it provokes you. And sometimes we are trying to know a lot about what is behind a movie, and sometimes what we don't see the movie because we pay too much attention to the names, to the reputations, to the prejudices or ideas that you have before seeing the movie. And somebody told you the movie's great, and so the people see it's great. Somebody tells you the film is awful, it's awful. And you know, I always said it's better to get there and see the film with your own eyes and have your own opinion and your own feeling about the movie, because you know we are so mediaticized that everything is already done for us.
It's getting worse and worse, though.
Yeah, it's getting worse.
I mean, it's interesting because now we're having that conversation. I'm having that conversation with critics about, you know, kind of preconceived notions, and it's almost hard to escape. I make a point of trying not to know much about a film before I see it, any film, whether it's a big studio film or whatever.
This wave of opinions. I was the other day invited in Madrid to a screening of a film that it's, I wouldn't say what film is, but everybody was speaking. It was not Spanish, but it was everyone was speaking very good about it. Oh, you gotta see it, you're gonna love it, it's great, you know. I went to see it and I hate it. So I went out and all the critics were there because it was a press pass, and they were there and they were like, oh, it's so good, the film is great, you know, it's true what they told us, you know, it's great. And I said, I hate it. And they were, well, yeah, why? And I said, well, because of this, you know, it's this cynical approach to all the characters, you know, it's again the director feeling that the stupid people, you know, it's around and making fun of the characters in the movie. I don't like that. And they say, well, yeah, maybe you're right. And so it's like you're changing the wave of the opinion because you're telling the truth or what you're feeling. And so that's what I ask the people, you know. You have to be faithful to you. You don't have to be faithful to what they told you.
Yeah. Well, the truth is somewhere there. You know, what is truth?
What is that? That case, you're true. The audience is the
audience will tell you in the end.
And the audience is always divided, you know. There is always someone that loves it and someone that hates it. Yeah. So what you ask for a critic is that don't be like a sheep, you know, everyone saying the same things about a film. Like, you know, I want you to explain why do you think that way.
No, it's getting harder. It's weird. Because it's harder not to get caught up in the mechanical, the machinery, the publicity, all that stuff. And then people are very, because of Twitter, I guess, and things like that, and Facebook, and God knows what, the immediacy of response from maybe a very few people, but it's so severe to people who are outside of the mainstream idea of what something is, that it's a form of harassment that people are no longer comfortable engaging. You know, it's an interesting problem. Since we're all, those of us who are critics are paid to engage. We're supposed to have strong opinions, right?
Sometimes, you know, the machine, you say the word, you know, the machine, you know, it's like now, you know, we're in October, end of October, okay. So every film that comes out is like an Oscar favorite. And you say, why didn't say that of the films that came out in February? Because some of them are great too. Mm-hmm. And some of them that are coming out here, they doesn't have, you know, the acting for an Oscar or the writing for an Oscar, but they say because it's October, November, so everything is Oscar kind of thing. And you say, why don't you escape from that a little bit? And
it's hard. Well, it's funny because now there's this, I've been lately thinking a lot about the fact that studios, you know, we always make fun of publicists, but they kind of know. And they pretend they don't know, and they tell you all these stories about what they think and how great it is or whatever. But you can tell by the way they handle things.
Oh, yeah, sometimes.
Because they have so much power now, particularly with media. They manipulate the media so much that you can tell by how they're manipulating the media whether they actually think they have something good or not. Mm-hmm. And then you see it and you go, oh, I understand why. I saw a movie last night and I was like, the studio had shown me like the first act of it before. Uh-huh. Like they showed me scenes from the first part of the movie and hadn't shown later parts. And I was like, I'm really looking forward to, it's not ready yet, it's not ready yet. And I saw the whole movie and I was like, oh, no wonder they focused on that part, because that was the best part of the movie. Okay. They didn't show me the part that was, they showed me the part that was great. And it was like, they're really smart. They're evil, but they're smart.
They are.
So when do you get your satisfaction? I mean, are you, when you're done cutting the movie and you've completed it, are you, and you're satisfied that you've done the best work you can at that point, is that where you sign off and you are happy, or are you waiting for response?
I'm never satisfied. I'm never happy. You know, I'm not that kind of person that ends and, you know, finish the editing or put the music in the film and finish mixing and says, you'll see, man, I have done the best film of the year. I'm not that kind of guy. I'm very self-critical, and I'm always having my doubts and insecurities. And even if a film like this that had a long, long career of awards and premieres, and you've seen the reaction everywhere, people is in love at the end of the movie, and even that, you know, you're always thinking that you could do change things, and I'm not satisfied, you know, and I'm not unhappy, you know, but I'm not satisfied. I'm not an easy satisfaction person, you know, with myself especially, because I'm so close to the film, because I wrote it and I did it and I directed and whatever, so that sometimes I'm very worried about if I arrived to tell the things in the way I wanted to tell them, and to transmit what I wanted to transmit. And I'm sure that this is something that you discover 20 years later, not in the moment that you're very hot with the movie. So I'm very humble about people. I'm listening to reaction of the people. I'm listening to what they write. And, you know, I'm like kind of getting an impression of how it's received. But it is always in myself, there is always like, when your kid left home, you always feel he's not ready to be all alone. So I have the same feeling with, very protective with my films. I would like to care them and the people to understand how many difficulties I have to make them. But that's impossible, so the film is done. And I always, when I started as a young guy to write and direct, I wanted the films to be like the pictures you see in an album, the family album, and then you look at yourself at 12 or 15 and you look ridiculous in the picture, but at the same time you cannot change the picture because it is you. You cannot Photoshop that because it's you. So I wanted to have the same relationship with my films, you know, that when I see them or when somebody speak about them, for me are related to a space and a time when I was the person that I did it, that I'm not that person anymore. So I'm not going to change anything because I'm not the same director anymore. So I'm thinking always about the next one. And probably all my worries and insatisfaction, they're going to be helpful for the next one, but not for the one that is done.
So do you let go at some point? Is there maybe a year or two later, or when you've made the other film? Or
you let in the moment you open the film, you let the film fly. You help with interviews and promotions and everything they ask you to do.
But you're done.
For the commercial career, but I'm not asking myself any more things about it. I'm thinking about the next one, you know. Mm. All the questions are for the next one, because it is the audience that finishes the film. That particular spectator that sees the movie and he's watching at the movie and he's finishing the movie. Mm. And you cannot enter in his mind. You cannot change his emotional, his experience, his, you know, his culture, his everything. So he's finishing in his way the movie. He's receiving the movie in his way. And I'm very respectful with that. When they told me about audience, I always think about one people. Mm. For me, audience is one people and one people and one people and one people, not a group of people. Because I know every one of them is receiving the film differently. And what I would like is that they have a good reaction, all of them, but that's impossible. And some of them are transported by the film, and some of them are, it's okay, you know, and some of them, they hate it. So you have to respect that if you know what you're doing.
So do you get pleasure from when you, at a movie like this, when it's clear that so many people love it? Do you take that to heart?
I get a selfish pleasure, a pleasure in the past. Because for me, it's something that I enjoyed to do, to make it. Mm-hmm. I enjoyed very much, and it was very important for me to create. And I'm happy that they enjoyed, but we're always talking in the past. Like,
So it's like watching your kid graduate from school.
Exactly. It's like, oh, great. But I remember when he was born, you know, he was crying. You're happy for the film. And I always say all the awards you won with the film, mm-hmm. it is the film that won the awards for you, not you. You know, this thing about the very selfish, egocentrical personality of directors and things, I'm always fighting against that. It is the movie that is going to win to the actors the award. It is the movie that is going to win for the director and the writer the awards. So it's not your talent and yourself, because you have your talent in other movies. Mm-hmm. And they didn't get that way, and you're not a stupid guy. You were trying to do it. It's the mix of what the film has inside that you don't control that it's gonna make. So you, when you say thank you to my mother, you should say thank you to the film. You know.
Well, it's not unlike parenting. I mean, parents have a hard time letting go of their kid, and
yeah.
you know, they identify if the kid fails, they feel like failures. If they succeed, they feel like success. But it's not. It is the kid is an individual uh-huh. human being, not a
yeah.
just a product of your loins.
Exactly.
So more kids soon?
Well, I'm not close to that.
Oh, I mean of the movie kid.
I'm gonna publish a novel, because I've written three novels in Spain, and I had the chance that they are translated in a lot of countries, but there is a long time since I didn't publish, so I'm publishing one novel in March in Spain. Mm-hmm. So now for me, it's all my mind is in that. Mm. I had some films growing in the mind, but they have to wait a little bit.
Excellent. Thank you so much. Appreciate
it. Thank you very much. It was a pleasure.